Welcome to the Public Voice Salon. We are an open dialogue on education, the arts, and social change, broadcasting today from Greenwich Village, which is the capital of Bohemia in the world. With us today is Jim. Jim, what's your last name?
Drougas. Yeah.
Jim Drougas, who is the owner of the one of my favorite bookstores in New York, the Unoppresive, Non-Imperialist Bookstore. You get that, folks? The Unoppresive, Non-Imperialist Bookstore. I think this is the only unoppressive bookstore in the world.
Oh, I'm not sure. You know, I like to think all bookstores are unoppressive, to be honest. You know, there are a few that are, I suppose. You know,
the big less oppressive than others.
I actually wrote a cute little remark, and most people get it. I came up with a cute little remark in my Facebook postings yesterday. It says, "Independent, working independent booksellers of the world unite. You have nothing to lose but your chain stores."
Oh, wow. Well, that's a big problem now with chain stores infiltrating into neighborhoods like the Village, too.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Wow, wow. Yeah. Jim, how long have you been here with this bookstore?
Oh, right. The store has been 23 years.
Yeah. Okay. What gave you the idea to start a bookstore? Were you into literature? Was that your background in terms of, you know, books and stuff?
I've loved books since I was a little kid. I mean, it's always been very... to be honest, the first notion of having a bookstore must have been... when I was about 12 years old, and there was an old bookseller in Patchogue, Long Island, that I used to visit in the summer.
Were you from Long Island, or are you from?
My family moved there, and when I was later, but it was a summer visit.
Where were you born?
Brooklyn, Sheepshead Bay area.
Oh, Brooklyn boy. Okay, yeah, okay.
For the first 15 some odd years, but okay. I spent the last 2 years of high school in Long Island. But the thing is, I remember distinctly thinking, wow, this is cool. There's this old guy selling books in this little used bookstore. And I was only like 12 or 13, but I was always obsessed with books and compulsively reading. And he was just this grumpy old guy who was pretty friendly somehow to me anyway. I was this, you know, funny little kid. And I just stacks and stacks of books everywhere. And it was just such a treasure trove to me. And I thought, you know, I might want to do this someday, you know. I think it was my first inkling of being a bookseller, probably, you know. And even I remember in like, what was it, in fifth or sixth grade, I used to...
Where did you go to school?
Well, in grade school, it was a public school in Brooklyn, PS98. It doesn't exist anymore.
Okay. What was school like in those days?
It was only like, you know, 20 some odd kids to a class, two classes per grade in that level. And what I was going to say is that I remember I would have a library of my own, and I would loan my books, like a lending library, to other kids in the class, even at that age.
So you were so book conscious.
Just purveyor at a very young age, too.
Wow.
And then coming into, I mean, a more realistic level, I mean, in terms of the first bookstore actually opened was called, it also had a long-winded name, it was called the Unknown Obscure Little Bookshop.
The Unknown Obscure Little Bookshop. And where was that? Where was that located?
Manhattan Beach in Brooklyn. And little tiny storefront, a little place I rented when I was in my early reckless 20s, you know, or mid-20s, really, you know. And I had like two or three customers. It was not very serious, but it was fun. And then quickly after that, I became the manager, creator of the High Times magazine bookstore, which was...
High Times magazine? You're talking about, wait a second, smoking pot and that kind of
stuff?
Right,
yeah.
Okay, wow.
I met the publisher at the time, and he just wanted to open a bookstore. And he already had a storefront in the heart of Soho. In 76, this was. And it was called New Morning Bookstore. It lasted several years, but it was a sensation at the very height of Soho's, you know, blossoming into
as a mecca of cultural life, as an avant-garde center. You had Jean-Michel Basquiat. That was later in the 80s. But how important was High Times to the culture of the 70s?
Well,
liberation spirit of do your own thing.
Yeah, there was a lot of, I think, culturally speaking, it had a big impact. And the store, and I mean, I can't speak for the whole magazine all that much, but I was certainly connected to the running up and down to their office on 27th Street. But there's the bookstore was part of that, that was my little island of that realm, and the it had a big impact in its day.
Were there celebrities that went through there?
Yeah, of course. I mean, there still is here, but there was Woody Allen was doing the movie Manhattan at the time, and we'd see that whole crew, Mariel Hemingway, Diane Keaton, and Woody himself would come in and out frequently. And you always knew you had to be like cool about it. You didn't want to be like he was usually, if there was too many people around, he'd try to be, you know, discreet about the fact that he was around at all. But you know, let's see, I remember Jane Fonda popped in, you know. She knew the publisher of High Times.
The High Times bookstore.
Right.
She came in and asked about you. Jane Fonda did.
Tom Forsad, who was my boss, the publisher.
Okay.
You know,
okay.
She was very sweet. She was smiling. You know, it was. Oh, we had Joni Mitchell came in. She wanted to learn about Krishnamurti because someone told her that I had a line on his teachings. There was. Let's see. We had Patti Smith. I mean, we had readings by Allen Ginsberg.
Meetings in your bookstore. Readings at High Times Bookstore.
We had.
She was a great intellectual.
Did a reading.
Mary Baraka. Yeah. Yeah.
We had a whole series of readings at that point too.
Where was it located again?
Spring Street, between West Broadway and Thompson. Pretty much at that time, it was pretty much the
early 70s, late 70s till when? Okay.
Mid 70s. Yeah.
Mid 70s. Yeah. Okay. Wow. Wow.
And Art Spiegelman, who's a good friend, was we were very close to him, actually. We would spend long nights doing little interesting projects with them too, and they helped us do a Art and Francois helped us do a little Soho newsletter at one point. We stayed up all night, you know.
Yeah.
Soho Book Review type thing, you know.
Wow. So you have all this bohemian background, which is incredible, and here you are on Carmine Street in the West Village. Claudia, look around the camera. Look around this vibrant streetscape here. This show is airing in New York City, throughout the city, those other non-bohemian neighborhoods like Midtown, and, you know, north of 14th Street. We don't want to talk about that, you know, what goes on north.
Yeah.
Because that doesn't exist. North of 14th Street is just like, you know, another, you know, and places like, God forbid, Hoboken, where Claudia and I live. although Hoboken's a little more bohemian in terms of, like, you know, human scale architecture you can walk and you can see people on the street that you know and say hello, you know.
There is nowhere else like the Village. I mean, let's face it. I mean, you'd go to London, Paris, there's nothing quite like it.
Internationally, Greenwich Village is known as being still the epicenter of what? Of culture, of avant-garde culture, of freedom of expression.
Yeah, it's always has been too, hasn't it? I mean, going way back, you know.
And still today, still.
Still, I mean, in spite of the fact that there's a lot of horrible, ugly things going on that are changing it, but it always goes through, it's always gone through decades and decades of different changes, transformations. I mean, you know, there's times when it gets a little too grungy and other times when it's a little too ungrungy, you know.
The crime rate was very high in the 70s and, you know.
And now it's, you know, it's almost too much the opposite, you know.
A lot of tourists now.
Yeah, but the tourists go everywhere now. I mean, they love, they go to Times Square, they go to the Meat District, they go to the Lower East Side, they go to Brooklyn, you know, they're spread out. I mean, the Village isn't really the heart of tourism as much as it was in some respects, because there's so many other destinations now, you know.
I discovered the Village as a Hoboken resident going to NYU and then, you know, seeing what the culture happening around me and then really coming alive to the neighborhood and discovering Judson Church and also, you know, making new friends and just becoming, absorbing the sort of creativity that's in the air. And just by wandering around and discovering places like your bookstore, like the Film Forum, Claudia, who's filming us, she has a Film Forum t-shirt on. You DC. She's wearing her Film Forum t-shirt. And very often when Claudia and I, we go to the Film Forum, which is one of the best places for cinema in the world, I think. Yeah. Well, if we get the ticket too early, and then we just, you're only a block and a half away from the Film Forum. Right. So we wander into your bookstore and we browse a little bit. But it's part of the intellectual atmosphere. Like you're, you know, seeing the books that you have here, browsing, and then going to see the film, and then maybe coming after the film. So we're going to take a walk now inside your bookstore and discover this incredible cave of you know, what's the word? It's just a beautiful, our audience will see, it's an aesthetic wonderland. It's a very quality, okay, good. Okay, now we're inside the store, the Unoppresive, Non-Imperialist bookstore on Carmine Street in Greenwich Village. And Jim, I wanted to say that our show began in a bookstore in Hoboken 5 years ago. This is our five-year anniversary. So we really celebrate, thank you, we celebrate bookstore culture in the world and the intellectual life and the social life around books. Mm-hmm. What is it like in terms of the conversations in here?
Oh, interesting you should ask, because there's actually a novel, I can't remember the name of it, that talks, this bookstore appears in the novel, and specifically saying just that this is the place that the character in the novel likes to go to have political conversations, which is so cute. It's like, we've actually mentioned in two different novels, and one is another one is like a noir fiction, murder mystery kind of thing, where again the main protagonist lives in this building and he lives above the Unoppresive, Non-Imperialist bargain bookshop, you know, and
it's so particular.
We exist in two fiction worlds, actually three if you count the movie Obvious Child, which is still another fiction realm where we exist, where we take part, you know. They even have a guy who plays the part of me in the movie, you know.
What?
Literally.
You're getting that famous, Jim? People are playing you now?
I'm depicted in movies, yeah. And my favorite depiction of me is actually myself, parodying myself, which was scripted, my daughter scripted me in a film that she's 20 and she was doing it as a school project, but she's got me ranting and raving about capitalism, and it's her script, of course, you know. But it's a wonderful little parody of me played by me, you know.
Okay.
But
have you radicalized your daughter, sir?
She's her own person. I mean, she did it herself, you know, but been exposed to a few things over the years, but
So we're talking about radical politics, too. We're talking about transformation, a better world that might be. We like to celebrate this on our show. Mm-hmm. I look up there and I see you have a map of South America for $4.50. Yeah. Claudia, who's my lovely co-producer, is from South America. She brought me to South America, to a little town called Chia, which is just outside of Bogota. And that expanded my horizons, you know, considerably in terms of politics on the left. There's a lot of activity happening in South America, you know. Yeah. And here you are in New York City, the vestiges of that Bohemian, which also has a lot of Marxism and a lot of, like, you know, in terms of visions of a better world. What sort of do political conversations still go on here at
I mean, all the time. I mean, I guess not only political, of course, but I mean there's
cultural too.
There's a lot of it's always, that's one of the fun things about doing this. I don't think I could do it if it wasn't fun, you know, and if it wasn't so enjoyable. And today's been a particularly interesting day. It was a lot of
talk about today. Let's talk about you said there was some kind of a film shoot going on today. We're not the only film shoot in here today.
Oh, okay. Not even today. Yeah, never mind. You know, we've had all in the past few weeks. I've had numerous, mostly young student journalists coming by to talk to us about this bill where they're trying to pass, you know, regarding some kind of rent control for commercial small businesses, and there's some.
You're part of that movement to save small businesses, and I think small businesses are closing at an alarming rate, and they're putting up Duane Reade's and Rite Aid's, and it's sort of a corporatization process that's going on.
About it, you know, it's getting really, you know. To the point where we hear that a lot here because people are so worried about us too, of course, but so we get a lot of There's not a day that goes by that people don't say, "Oh my God, I'm so glad you're still
here."
In fact, the movie I mentioned a moment ago, in the movie, the guy who plays me is explaining to the girl who is the main character in the movie that we have to close this door.
Because the landlords
gave us 6 weeks to get out.
And I want to say one thing right now to the world. If this store ever closes, I'm out of New York. There's no reason to be in New York anymore. If this store closes, I'm out of here.
I've heard this a lot.
This and the Film Forum, okay? Those are my two favorite places in the city for social, cultural, intellectual enrichment. Mm-hmm. And it's like you guys are like a 1-2 punch. You're like right next to each other.
Right. Thank you. And we've had, today I actually had another young student who's talking about doing a biopic about Shelley, the poet. And how neglected he is. And we talked about Blake, my favorite poet. And it was,
you like Blake. Blake was really deep, and he was radical.
It's a lot of interesting conversation about the anarchist William Godwin, who was a friend of Blake's, who was the father-in-law. I guess you'd say the father-in-law of Shelley, in effect, because Shelley stole his 17-year-old daughter, Mary Shelley, away from him when he was being mentored by...
Now we're gossiping.
...Godwin, the anarchist. Great fun. That's part of the fun of having...
Who wrote Frankenstein? Who was...
Literary gossip.
Who wrote Frankenstein?
Mary Shelley, of course.
Okay,
And who was the daughter of Mary Wollstonecraft, who was a close
feminist.
Another friend of Blake's, who... speaking of gossip, apparently there's a lot of suggestion that Blake might have had an affair with her.
Is that right?
Yeah, and we've been trying to locate the love letters between them. No, I'm kidding.
Okay. But no affairs have taken place in the store, though.
Nothing I'm aware of.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, this is the village, right?
And my wife's right over there.
Oh, your wife is. So anyway, let's. Okay, be careful. Yeah. Okay. Anyway, here we are in the village, and it doesn't get more authentic than this. It doesn't get more feeling of aliveness and intellectual aliveness, and also I think a sense of social possibility. That's also a problem in our country. We've been addressing this on our show. I've been writing about it. I just wrote a letter to the editor of the Hoboken Reporter that hopefully will be published next week about the silences in our society. I think that there are social silences and political silences. Mm-hmm. And even in some other bookstores that we're not going to mention, you go into the bookstore and it's very corporatized, and it's like people go in and out and they get the book and run. Mm-hmm. This seems like a kind of the opposite of that. Mm-hmm. People will linger.
Right, yeah, okay. That's true. Usually you don't have the opportunity to... they have events, of course, in bookstores. And then there are other places that are even more inviting that way, that have cafes like Blue Stocking, for example, and
Blue Stockings is a great bookstore.
It's a great place. I mean, we like them, there's a coziness to the atmosphere here for that, and people just assume that by the nature
cozy,
of the books we
cozy
sell,
cozy is the key. Neoliberalism is not cozy. Mm. Neoliberalism is cold, it's corporate, it's effective, it expands the bottom line, everybody's talking about branding this, branding that. Mm. When you talk to people who studied marketing, they have very sharp way of speaking. There's like a, I have a hard time talking to people with a straight business background. There's a lack of humanity there, there's a lack of humanity.
What's interesting is young people who do that, who do study those things, we're seeing them coming in saying, whoa, I wish I could be you, I wish I could be you. I wish I could do this,
I wish I could be you too, Jim.
I've heard
can
that
I,
a lot.
Can I have the hat?
No.
Okay.
The same person I spoke about earlier, the one with the Shelley biopic.
Okay, yeah.
She's talking about her sister studied fashion, and now after going through finishing school, 4 years of whatever of schooling, and she's just hates it. She hates the whole the atmosphere of that realm.
Okay.
So I said, well, maybe what she should do is become like a journalist who basically disavows fashion and criticizes it and tells that story that she now believes.
The shallowness, the emptiness, the banality of fashion, it's horrible.
And there's another young person who's like sheepishly saying, I studied this and that. I mean, like, I think it was marketing or whatever. And she's like, and we're hearing more and more how they don't really want to be in that world. They really want
to. I have to try to go easier on the people in business. I think they're human. And they kind of like because right. of the economic. Here's the thing. Now in our society today, there is so much wealth. There is so much surplus, and with technology, there's enough to go around. Right. We'd all have enough to read, time to read, to hang out in bookstores, to hang out with you, and to have conversations with people.
It took you 6 weeks to get here.
It took us a while to put this together. I know it really did, and your wonderful wife, who is back there, if she wants to come on and say a few words, she's welcome. Always welcome. The two of you are a very creative couple. Mm-hmm. I always see you guys as an amazing creative couple, because two of you, this is not just a bookstore. It's like a movement. It's a project. It's a party. It's a phenomenon. Yes. It's something else entirely.
Because
it's in the village. It's where it's situated, and it's what your backgrounds are, and did you come together through books in any way?
We met in Nicaragua, actually, at a book fair. Yeah, at a trade.
Hence the map of South America or Central America?
Central America is up there. Okay, yeah, you can see Nicaragua on the top, actually. Yeah, come to think of it. Yeah.
So how'd you guys meet in Nicaragua?
I went down there to visit a book fair, actually. I learned about it 29 years ago, I guess, something like that. And she was working one of the tables there, actually.
Wow.
Sat down for a few minutes talking. I bought a few books from her. Some guy came along and took a picture of us together. Well, he took my camera and said, "Can I take a photo?" And so we have a photo of the first few minutes that we ever met, which is pretty cool.
It's smiling.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Oh.
Just sitting there, you know, smiling at the camera, which is quite cute. And then there's we had a lot of rendezvous since then, a lot of letters and phone calls, and we met back and forth, and finally managed to get her up here. And you know, we got married about 26 years ago.
That's beautiful. I'm going to name names now. I'm going to name names, and I'm going to say that you go into a Barnes & Noble, okay? You buy a book there. Very rarely do you have a conversation with the person, because there's someone behind you on a line, and it's like a factory going through. Do you have any memories of particular conversations here or recent conversations?
We spoke about the one I just mentioned. That was kind of fun. But there's some. what else? Recently, a lot of film conversations because of the movie. We hear
because of Film Forum being close by.
Because
you were in a movie. About that. How did you get into a movie? How did that happen?
Well, the thing is, the director of the film was roommates with a woman who used to work here, and with whom I had that very sort of conversation about, like, at a precarious moment where the landlord was breathing down our neck, and how things weren't looking too good for us. So it was like, clearly that segment of that movie was based on that real life reality about the store and her roommate at that time. But the point is too that we see people who, when the movie was playing around the corner, and even now while it's on.
What movie were you in? What was
Obvious Child?
Obvious Child. What's it about?
It's about a young woman who gets an abortion, but it's not a ugly, scary, miserable situation. It's sort of like she accidentally gets pregnant with this new boy she sleeps with for the first time, and so on, and so, sort of. It's a cute comedy.
This will not be approved by the Republican Party.
No.
Ted Cruz will not be going to see it anytime soon.
No.
Okay.
But it was quite a big sensation in its day, and it's still out there. It's on DVD. It's on Netflix, I think. So we still get a lot of people coming and saying, "I just saw that on a video." You know, like you were, and frequently saying, "I'm so glad you're still here." You know, because in the movie, of course, we're closing this door, and she's packing boxes and closing the. You know, so, and in the film, for example, when the character who plays me says, "Well, we've got 6 weeks to pack it up," and she says, "No, they can't do this. This place is so important to so many people, and it's like I was easy." And then she goes, "But what am I going to do? You know, it's easy for you. You'll just go to Woodstock or something." And I say in the film, not me, of course, "Oh well, yeah, maybe that's a good idea or something." And then the thing is, And in fact, we do have a house in Vermont, which is probably Woodstock is code for Vermont, I guess, in the film. I don't know. But
now, who played you? Was it George Clooney?
No, I was thinking was I should have gotten Iggy Pop to play.
Iggy Pop.
That's a lot like me, you know, vice versa, you know.
Has he ever been in here?
Not that I'm aware of. You know, we do have to meet someday because he looks a lot like me. You know, you know, he's taller, but, you know, we have a similar look somehow. And, you know, but no, we've had, in here, we've had, Patti Smith is probably the most conspicuous celebrity because she lives nearby anyway.
Comes here.
And she's a big William Blake
fan. Hi, Patti. I love Patti Smith. I love Patti.
She, over the years, I mean, she's been the most visible. Famous, but Susan Sarandon, Tim Robbins.
Oh, she's wonderful.
Yoko,
these are
Yoko and Sean
Ono,
both, you know,
the top quality progressive intellectual celebrities in the world.
Yes,
come here, folks. Here.
My favorite celebrity of all is Professor Irwin Corey.
We love him. We're trying to get him on our show. We're
good.
Trying,
yeah. Well,
we're working on.
Well,
that,
I'll bring you up there. I mean, he's he loves us, and you know. And he's a lot of fun, you know. He's one of my favorite humans. Never
however.
That's right.
Okay.
However, yeah.
Wow. No, I mean, this is something. I mean, all this content is just, I have to reflect on it a little bit here, you know. I mean, Susan Sarandon, I saw her in 2000 at Madison Square Garden when Ralph Nader was running for president, and Patti Smith, and Bill Murray. Mm-hmm. So maybe Bill Murray has to find out about this place.
Yeah, we haven't seen him. Well, Richard Gere, he comes around.
Of course he would.
You know,
Richard Gere
again.
Would go.
Yeah.
Where's the New Age section? where would he like? The Zen Buddhism, he would go over there.
Tibetan Buddhism, actually, I think. Yeah.
So Richard comes here. What about now? This is the Hollywood section right here. So it's ironic that we're talking about movies, and there's the Grove Book of Hollywood. I bought a book here by Andrew Light, who is a professor of film studies at NYU, and the book is called Real Arguments, R-E-E-L, Arguments, Film Philosophy and Politics or something. Right. And it's one of the most enriching books on cinema. I happened to buy it on a day that Claudia and I went to Film Forum. Once a year they have a program called Meet the Programmers, because we're members of Film Forum. So the benefit is of being membership, you get reduced price on ticket price, and which is great. And then once a year, there's something called Meet the Programmers, that you get to meet Karen Cooper, Bruce, and you know, friend. Anyway, they do that to talk about you know, why they choose their movies and stuff like that. And after that, I came here, and I bought that book on film and philosophy. So the two of those events just somehow fuse in my imagination as you know.
So much synchronicity here of that sort. I mean, it's scary sometimes, you know.
Wow, you could probably write a book about this.
I agree. Yeah, I mean, we do post a lot. You've seen it on Facebook. A lot of little cute little anecdotes about things like that when we can. Not that I'm a fan of Facebook per se, but it's an easy
forum. I'm very, very ambivalent about Facebook. I try not to spend too much time on it.
And, no, I don't do that.
But it's just a lot of corporate stuff and fluffy stuff, and it gets tiring after a while, right? It gets
it's just a practical way to reach people, I guess.
Yeah, I guess so.
Past.
Yeah, so I think what you're doing is essential, and you were also at that event at Judson Church that had a couple of months ago. It was on a cold wintry night, it was snowing out, and they had 100 people who showed up for a forum on small businesses, the crisis of small businesses in New York, that they're closing at an alarming rate, okay, and you were there. You were the only person from a small business who was there, okay, because people are afraid. A lot of small business owners are afraid because the landlords might get mad.
People, not too many speaking, I guess.
Yeah. What could be done about this?
Well, I think the approach that they've taken at these forums is a little too tame, and I think that needs to be a stronger
street actions, protesting,
Occupy type stuff. Yeah, maybe, you know, or but also just a more vehement attitude. I mean, there is some strong words being said, and there is a lot of uproar, but somehow I printed up a giant banner to put in the window, which it wasn't practical forever, but it's we'll put it back soon. And it's basically, there's an interesting comment on the articles in the Villager that appeared quickly after that, saying, you know, we have to get the names of all these people who are going to vote on this, you know, and really put pressure on them to you know, basically say, well, you want to get reelected, you better support this, you know, and because after all, the point it being that it's the voters ultimately who have the the ultimate say and yeah. over who gets to make these decisions.
Well, I want to give credit to Sharon Willems, our friend Sharon, because she's been really good on this. She's been writing a series of letters in The Villager,
that's right, yeah.
calling attention to this issue, and also she's the one who organized that forum at mm-hmm. at Judson Church. And also Steve Null, who's an incredible activist, mm-hmm. and Steve yeah, has been really on point on this, yeah. and they've been trying to get the awareness out. Here's something that I never thought I would ever say. We've been thinking actually about leaving New York. Because of the situation, you know, mm-hmm. because I get tired of going into cafes and, you know, just not hearing interesting conversations and not, or I get tired of the hyper-competitiveness that New York has become the epicenter of corporate capitalism, mm-hmm. that it's too hyper-rushed and it's got to slow down, otherwise it's going to lose that character. So the money is now perverting the social landscape of what it once was, and there are other places in the country, you know, places like Berkeley, California, Cambridge, Massachusetts, you know, that are a little bit more still intellectual, still cultural, you know, but I think New York, and a lot of people now are saying that New York is over. They're actually saying New York is over, so what about that?
It's not over. I mean, it's okay, like, if you guys all leave, what's going to happen? I mean, what the you know,
okay,
like,
we'll stay.
Do we'll, this, you know.
We'll visit. We'll visit.
Us okay. to California of all places. That's okay. horrible. Okay. You know. Are you joking? I mean, this okay. is. You're just trying to provoke me, right?
Yes.
I,
exactly.
I
exactly.
knew this. Yeah. you know. I mean, no. You know, it's not going to happen. Oh, you know, you're so full of. This is not going to happen.
One
you know.
Of my favorite movies is Annie Hall, right? And right. there's that whole conflict. His friend goes to California yeah. to work in television.
Yes.
And Woody is like, how could you possibly go there? All they do is give awards to each other all day. You know, it's like...
right.
And he's in a restaurant, and he's ordering... He orders a plate of mashed yeast, you know.
Yes.
He's parodying that kind of... Mm-hmm. that superficial culture. But New York is still great, and I think you're right, but I think it has to be preserved, and I think bookstores like this are part of the fabric and character, bakeries, cafes, but Cafe Dante just closed.
Yeah, yeah, I know.
100 years, Cafe Dante on McDougal Street, and they finally closed.
Yeah, no, I mean, all the more reason that we need to gather momentum and not allow this to go on like this. And I think, no, and never mind, this is happening everywhere. It's not just New York.
Yeah.
This is the whole world. I mean,
it's
this
transnational
is,
capitalism.
It's not just, yeah, it's yeah, not yeah. just New York. Think yeah. about it. And it's like, yes, there are still a few pockets yeah. that are less affected, but it's only a matter of time before, if we
yes.
let the those
yeah.
elements take, you know,
okay.
that much force over us, we're sunk. You know, we have yes. to just fight back. You know?
Karl Marx.
Yeah.
Read them. Karl Marx.
Exactly what I said, but in German, actually. You know, and
where is Das Kapital? Which shelf is it on?
I actually don't have it. There was a cute story, one other great anecdote.
Okay.
There were three little 15-year-old guys passing by the store one day, and one of them was shouting, oh, yeah, there's that communist bookstore. All they sell is the Karl Marx's Communist Manifesto. That's all they sell there, you know. Just like hilarious in a way, but we do have it now. I mean, but we don't. It's not all that we're about, obviously.
Okay.
But and it's not. We're not that specific, really. And politically speaking, I mean, we're all over the place, and
yeah.
because we have to be. We're a bookstore, you know.
Well, you are a gentle soul, my
not
friend.
All over the place in the right, but
yeah.
all over the left is what I meant to say. You know.
You have such a kind presence, and I think you helped to create the community, you and your wife, that this place embodies, that radical energy, that sense of peace and love that the 60s and 70s represented, that Patti Smith represents, that Susan Sarandon is all about. Mm-hmm. You embody that spirit here better than anybody in terms of bookstores, and, you know, it's tiny, but that's how powerful it is. It's like there's a quality to the... You know,
yeah.
small is good.
That's true. Yeah, we're shrinking probably too. But
you now half of your place is now a comic book store. What happened?
Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah, the lease came up at one point. It was a matter of survival, and it's lucky they came when they did.
Uh-huh.
They're noisy and obnoxious, and you know, but it's okay. You know.
Is it okay to say that? Is there a cold war going on between the comic book side and the literary
yeah.
side? Okay.
No, but it's you know.
Do you get mad sometimes? So let's be honest now.
Oh. I'm pretty relaxed, but
okay.
there are moments when I have to say, whoa, you know, like, yeah. And they can be
yeah.
vulgar.
It's a different crest, a different clientele.
Universe,
it's
in a way. But they're okay. Yeah,
there's some overlapping and intersecting.
Quite a lot of, yeah, certainly. I mean, they're yeah. interested in the books, too, and
yeah.
we're interested in some of the comics.
Yeah. So there is
yeah,
sort of a kind of interconnections that could happen between comic book land and literary... You know,
it's
political.
It works. I mean, it's a good connection, and there are a lot of people who are disappointed, like, why can't we have the whole store? But it's just not affordable. It was a matter of survival. And when it happened, it was lucky it did, you know.
Jim, at the time that's left, I want you to be free to articulate a message of some kind of what it is that you want to accomplish and what, in terms of, you know, what you've done so far, just recapping in terms of, you know, this bookstore culture, this literary life, this political consciousness that you bring to this Greenwich Village and to New York and to the world, and what is the future going forward? How are you going to keep this strong, or what's your strategy?
Okay, well, It's hard to say. I'm open. I'm open to whatever happens, and we'll fight the fight. We'll you know, stay here as long as we can, and we'll enjoy it as much as we can too, because that's the most, I think, the one thing they can't take away from us is that, you know, we can still enjoy the books, the life that we have for as long as we're alive. You know, I mean, you know, everything eventually evaporates into dust eventually anyway. So, you know, whatever, you know, we'll all be underwater someday, you know. But in the meantime, we'll just get as much enjoyment as we can out of it, and we'll press forward to you know, bring the word out to as many people as we can about what is worthwhile here. And
there was a sign, you put a sign in the window recently to support the Small Business Job Survival Act. Right. This is an act that's before the New York City Council that has been bottled up for, I think, a decade. And if it passes, if de Blasio gets behind this, and he claims to be progressive, if he gets behind that, this would actually allow businesses to negotiate with the landlords, and so the landlords couldn't double and triple the rent. That's what's going on now. They're gouging people. Exactly. All of a sudden, you go from paying $5,000 rent to $12,000 rent, and that's what's happening.
Yeah, the tenants have no power whatsoever. I mean, the minute the lease is up, it's like you have nothing to go with. Yeah. And they're trying, and to be honest, bill is pretty mild. It's not really hardcore at all in terms of what it gives the tenant, but it's something. It's better than nothing, it's a step, you know.
I was working in real estate for a while, but I couldn't stand it. I got out of it. It was just so shallow and superficial. Superficial. I couldn't see it. When you found out I was going into real estate, you were like, what? That's the enemy. That's the enemy. Okay.
No, I'm kidding.
But no. Okay. You were like, check, please. No. But I'm so glad I got away from it. But I wrote a series of books on ethical business and how business ought to be transformed, that a new bottom line implemented that would that would seek to maximize not just profit, but also caring, but also care about community and people, because this corporate capitalism on steroids now only cares about profits. To hell with the community and to hell with people. So that's, I wrote a couple of books on that, and I published that. I had an ethical business society for a while, but I'm so glad to be done with that and to be focusing only on our show, on my writing and my teaching. And I just want to be around people like you, because when I got into business, I got around these empty suit types, and they got to me. Not that they're not our good people in business who are caring and have more, you know, intellectual qualities, but a lot of them now today are just cutthroat and out for themselves and very selfish. And real estate, I'm calling you on this now, the real estate industry. There was an article published in The Villager by some big shot in real estate, and he said, you know what he said? That people want Duane Reades. They want Rite Aids on every corner. Can you imagine that?
Yeah, that's bullshit. And it's, the fact is, it's not just about the Duane Reades, and it's not just about the greedy landlords, and it's or the greedy real estate agents. It's who will sell their
souls, sell their grandmother's soul
for a commission. Yeah, right. But it's, and ruin people's lives for a commission if they could, you know. It's also, it's the nature of the whole system where you've got people buying buildings for two-story building like the drugstore around the corner for $14 million, and it doesn't matter if it's empty. The notion the fact that he's asking $60,000 a month for a small store like that is meaningless, because from his point of view, if he can't get at least $60,000 from it, it's not even worth bothering. I'd rather leave it empty, because all he wants to do, it's a commodity. The building is these buildings are commodities. They're just he's just buying and selling property like stock. You know, it's a matter of like, oh, maybe I could sell it for $5 million profit in 2 years. You know, and it's not and so it's better to leave the stores empty. How many empty stores are there?
Terrible.
Not because they don't you know. They can't find a tenant that's stupid enough to pay the ridiculous rent, because they don't even care if there's a tenant. It's not about rent. It's about selling the building for a gigantic profit as quickly as possible.
So
you've got money launderers, you're buying buildings, you've got criminals, you've got terrorists, you've got who knows what kind of, governments and other things, buying and selling buildings under other false identities. And there was a big article about the Times about this, not that long ago, and it's all, these people have to be exposed. They have to thrown in jail. I mean, why isn't, the people who work in the banks, they're nice people, lovely
the
people.
The actual people,
but, but Jamie Dimon is the biggest on earth.
Well,
arrogant piece of shit.
Watch the language. We're going to have to cut all that out.
Well, bleep me. Jamie Dimon is the most arrogant jerk on the planet that ever lived, And, you see the story about how Elizabeth Warren was sitting with him in the Senate chambers, and she's telling him when she passes these laws, he can't do this and that, and he goes, no, I'll just keep on doing what I do, and you'll fine me, and I can afford to pay the fines. Well, I don't care, What do I care,
Let's try to be hopeful now, Jim. I think the Occupy Wall Street was a good sign and a step in the right direction. I think consciousness is raising. People will watch this show. So I'm very hopeful in terms of, that this will eventually turn itself around. And if we keep reading, if we keep educating ourselves, so you're providing a vital function here as an educator. Let's sort of end on a hopeful note, an intellectual note, in terms of being hopeful. Talk about your reading habits. What have you been reading lately?
Matt Taibbi, I like his work a lot.
Matt Taibbi, okay.
Yeah, he does these hilarious things with there's a recent book, but there's also a lot of pieces in Rolling Stone over the years, And the really nice exposés about all those things we just spoke about.
Yeah.
And has a positive note to it, too. And it's like, he's great, and he appears on TV a lot, too.
Sure. What's the book called?
I don't have it, and I don't remember it. I'm afraid, but we shouldn't ask that. But
book of essays.
Yeah, there's a collection of recently, and there's been a few books out that over the years we've had some of them on occasion.
And what is it of his reading that you've just been exposed to that stands out the most? What points did he make there? Really,
the way he exposes these crooked people that, like Jamie Dimon, for example, and yet still has a positive note take on it too.
Yeah. Robert Reich is also very good on that, too.
Yes.
Robert Reich exposes things.
Yeah. Yeah. Over the years, I've been reading a lot of Philip K. Dick. He's a great prophet, science fiction writer.
He was the prophet of the dystopian future that seems to be actualizing.
Correct he's been, I still reread Blake a lot of the same people that I've always been interested in.
You know, Jonathan Lethem is a big fan of Philip K. Dick. Jonathan Lethem, his essay collection is wonderful.
He was involved in some of the editorial work on some of the posthumous books. Yeah. It was Spiegelman who turned me on to Philip K. Dick. He's the one who introduced me to him. Yeah.
But I wanted to mention about Lethem, that Lethem was from Brooklyn, like you, born and raised in Brooklyn. But he left New York, and he said he found it very difficult to write in New York anymore. Mm-hmm. So I thought that was interesting. So maybe that presages something. Something's in the air here that's antithetical to creativity, maybe.
He'll be sorry when he can't come back, It's like... After we
so
turn,
you are a diehard New Yorker. You're not going anywhere.
Well,
you're going down with the ship.
I don't know.
I hope the ship doesn't go down. But what if it does? I mean.
Well, we have Vermont. We have Nicaragua.
Vermont. Yeah. Bernie Sanders, my favorite presidential candidate.
And Vermont is actually a suburb of New York in a way.
Is it really?
Yeah. Nobody knows that, but it's
Well, now we know.
Yeah.
What's your favorite place in Vermont?
Well, we have a house in Rochester.
Parties this summer?
Yeah, beginning of August.
Could film something there. Maybe a salon up in Vermont. We'd get Bernie Sanders to come over. Bernie.
That's
okay.
Great. We love Bernie. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Bernie the socialist.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's not a dirty word anymore, is it?
Not to me, it isn't.
Einstein was a socialist.
Of course he was, yeah. Bertrand Russell, this goes on. H.G. Wells.
H.G. Wells, one of my favorites.
Yeah, they're all, And
you know, my uncle Larry was a spy, and he had a doctorate from Bern in Switzerland. He knew 20 languages, and he was behind the Iron Curtain having a conversation with H.G. Wells on the reviewing stand of the May Day Parade.
Wow.
He infiltrated that, and then Stalin found out that Wells was there, and he had Wells pulled over to sit next to him. That's one of my favorite family stories. But H.G. Wells, the time machine, he was also a great intellectual. He wrote history.
He wrote great essays, too, yeah.
A man of the left. He was a man of the left.
Exactly. Yeah, and some even theater. I mean, he read, you know, plays. And there's so many interesting... And it's not just socialism. I mean, I think of myself more as an anarchist than a socialist.
Anarchist. Yeah. No rules.
Sort of, yeah.
Okay. Well, do your own thing. Let it all hang out.
Not exactly, but you know.
No clothes. No.
Yes. Free love. Yes.
Free love at Unoppresive, Non-Imperialistic.
Yes, girls, come on down. You know.
Non-Puritanical bookstore.
I'm kidding. You know.
The last hippie alive, my friend.
No, I'm not.
Let's get all you guys together and make a show. Let's do like another Woodstock.
Yeah.
Right here, okay?
Right.
Or you know.
Intellectual Woodstock.
Intellectual Woodstock.
Yeah.
I want you to take charge of that, okay?
All right. I'm in charge. I might actually compete with you. I might do my own show, you know.
You should have a show. Claudia, we got to...
Can I hire you?
We'll put a good word in for you with our producers up at NIA. I think you need a show.
Yeah. I mean, you know. Yeah, we could do it every week. You know.
Claudia said that you would have a show very easy.
Exactly.
Here. And I think, yeah, just Jim being Jim, just follow you around.
I kind of do it already, but I just don't have a camera and a microphone in front of me every day. But, you know, but thank you for coming. It was really a pleasure to work to do this with you, and, you know. And anytime, you're always welcome to come back and bring your friends. And
not too many friends, though, because...
It's small, but you know.
We don't have that many friends anyway, so.
Oh yeah, me neither. Well, yeah.
But after
I consider all my customers friends. My son is 13 now. When he was 7, he used to call everybody we knew, friends. You know, he'd say, "Oh, there's," they would call them customers. You know, because that's everybody. You know, it was to him, all people were customers. You know, it was like, you know.
You know, I watch a lot of talk shows on TV. I've never seen a bookstore owner ever on any shows. I go around CNBC and Fox. I never saw a bookstore person there. Now, you would think, with education being such a number one vital issue, that bookstores are a key element, and you would think there'd be TV programs on this.
And booksellers are such smart people and such interesting...
Of course, we found that out here today. We found that out.
I don't get that. Yeah.
You know. I mean, what do we watch? We watch Sex and the City. I was walking by, you know, Perry Street the other day, where this store, and the young girls are getting their pictures taken, and like Gaga, you know, with the selfies in front of where they film Sex and the City. Hey, I'm not knocking it, because a show is a show, and you need all different kinds of programs and entertainments and this and that. But I think intellectual life and growth and pedagogy and educative program, dialogue, I think is given short shrift by our mainstream media today.
That's true in a way. And but, you know, we do okay for ourselves. I mean, we get, without having any of that behind us, you know, TV shows, et cetera. There isn't a day that goes by that people don't get a chuckle and a picture of our sign with the name Unoppresive, Non-Imperialist Bargain Books. It's not one day. I mean, that's a lot of days. So that picture is over 23 years and 360. If you multiply 23 by 365, I mean, I'm saying at least one or two pictures, not less, you know, sometimes many, many pictures. And a large, you know, accumulation of chuckles out of it, too, you know.
You think that, Jim, we could actually get rich people behind this whole movement to save the world? I mean, Ralph Nader wrote a book, Only the Super Rich Can Save Us. Yeah. You would think a few of them would say, hey, you know.
Yeah. I guess. But, I mean, we can't rely on them, obviously. I mean, they're not reliable. The thing is, we have to change that.
A guy who's worth $25 billion, okay, could easily live on $1 billion. Wouldn't you be nice? $1 billion would be enough, right? $25 billion. You could take 24 of that billion and say, we're going to solve poverty. We're going to cure cancer. We're going to, you know, it's true. It's absolutely true. And yet they hang on to all that out of selfishness, out of greed. What is that?
Well, they're hoarders. That's how they got to be where they are, I guess.
It's a mental illness, actually. Yeah. I think there's a psychosis going on.
But, you know, I guess that none of them, no single rich person is going to solve all of our problems either. But I think we need to fix it so that it doesn't work that way, that just a few people don't get to keep everything.
Transform the system systemically, structurally, so that the wealth is distributed.
It's really rigged against us and in their favor, and it just needs to be re-rigged, you know.
And the only way to do that is to have people conscious, to have people have knowledge, and so reading and a culture of literature and education would also contribute toward that.
Some of those rich people who got there illegitimately in jail once and for all, like the Jamie Dimons of the world, need to really get put away. You know, they can't, they shouldn't be allowed to say, "Oh yeah, just fine me and I'll pay the fine. I can afford it." That's not okay. You know.
Yeah. So Jamie Dimon's never been in here.
Not that I'm aware of,
You don't have like a corporate finance section, I see.
No, not really. An anti-corporate finance section.
You know, Blue Stockings, I was over there the other day, they have they have an activist strategy section. I thought that was interesting. First time I saw that as a category in a bookstore.
Yes.
Activist strategy.
A lot of interesting categories. It's fun.
I actually gave a lecture there the other day. I gave a lecture there called The Magic Dialogue of Democracy. And 12 people showed up. And I thought that was, you know, not bad. It's a small store, you know, and it was a good dialogue. And when I thought, you know, I made some mistakes, and I'm sort of emerging on the lecture circuit now, and I'm sort of trying to get better at that. So I'm willing to give a lecture here.
Yeah, you can lecture me anytime, you know.
I'll buy you coffee and then give you a lecture.
Yes, cappuccino preferably. Yeah.
Do you have a favorite cafe to overhear conversations?
Huh. Well,
is the cafe life getting also kind of alienating also?
I usually drink here, but you know, I just pick it up to go. But I mean, there's this one next door named Masa that's very new and very nice people, and not too crowded yet because it's new.
Because Bohemia to me is cafe life, bookstores, cinema, art galleries.
Right.
That's Bohemia. And the great thing about the Village is you have a lot of that in proximity, plus you have the new school and NYU.
Right.
So I think there's enough of an infrastructure of intellectual culture for it to be sustained. What do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. And
I'm going to stay and fight.
Yeah, me too. We're not going to let you leave.
You're not going to let me go? You're not going to let us go?
I'm here, you know, for the duration. I mean, I'm not going anywhere, you know.
This is the coolest bookstore. It feels kind here. It feels humane. The energy here feels authentic. And all of that is true. And so come and be enriched in this place, and let's hope that that enrichment will continue to go out there. We're trying to provide with our TV show a kind of a university on the public, you know, sort of airwaves, you know, so people can get educated. What would be like a final message that you might want to give the people in terms of their own intellectual life, in terms of reading culture and politics?
Well, just try to be open, you know, try to be open-minded, open-hearted, open to all the possibilities, I think you know, it's I guess it's difficult to point to one direction. You know, I don't like to be to embrace any specific ism anyway. You know, or any specific you know. Ideology as such.
A constellation of strategies and...
Perhaps, multifaceted course, you know, perhaps. Not because, you know, not because I don't have specific tendencies to embrace one myself, but I'm not a joiner anyway, really. I'm not a member of any specific thing as such.
Well, Woody Allen said this. He said, "I would never want to join a club that would have me as a member."
I think that was Groucho, wasn't it?
Oh, Groucho said that? Maybe that was Woody quoting Groucho, because he liked Groucho.
He liked Groucho, yeah.
But what if Woody Allen makes a movie that's about politics, that's radical, that gets people to laugh and watch it, and then it elevates people's consciousness? You know, Woody, are you watching? Make a political movie, Woody. Come on.
Yeah, there's some politics in his work too.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah.
You know,
in a subtle way, maybe.
Yeah, and I think I have no complaints about his work, really. I enjoy it.
And
again, the humor is an important factor. I mean, not just in terms of...
Yeah.
I mean, not only about Woody's... Funny films are his best, of course, but seriously.
Yeah.
You know, I think the other point, too, is as a final thing, is to say that it's just... don't get too serious. I mean, you know, from my point of view, it's so important to be at least have some whimsical, approach to life. And
you're very funny, Jim. I think sometimes things come out with the stories.
I try to be subtle about it, but I'm glad you noticed. Yeah, yeah.
Right. one of our guests of our show, one of our favorite guests, was Pat Cooper.
Yes,
who was another another Brooklynite, mm-hmm. Pasquale Caputo. He's 85 years old.
Yeah.
He was on our show last August.
Mm.
He was hysterical. He had retired officially, but we got him to come on our show.
Nice.
And just for a whole hour, I mean, he was just entertaining and fun. But there's something very real about that too. The humor, there's an honesty. He tells it like it is. Maybe there's something about Brooklyn that produces this honest, intellect and humor.
And humor, just keep laughing. That's
keep laughing. Mm. Have fun. Change the world.
At the same time.
Yeah. Read.
Yeah. Okay. Don't take yourself too seriously.
This is wisdom from the Unoppresive Non-Imperialist Bookstore in Greenwich Village. And I'm with my lovely wife, Claudia. And without her love, without her support, this would not be possible. I always like to say that because love is very important in terms of our growth and our emotions and our creativity. And I see you and your lovely wife also work as a nice team here. So let's try to do, as Paulo Freire said, let's try to make a world in which it's easier to love. That's what Paulo Freire said, who's also from South America, from Brazil up there, I see. And he said we need to teach for a world that's easier to love. And I try to do that in my teaching. I'm teaching now American literature at Boricua College, which is the first private Puerto Rican college in the United States. Mm. Two campuses in Brooklyn, one campus in the Bronx, and one in Manhattan in Washington Heights. And I teach there once a week. I teach American literature to Latino kids. You know what? I told them about bookstores, and I mentioned the Strand. I'm sorry if I admit that here, but I did mention it. And a couple of my students actually went to the Strand. Mm. But now I'm just remembering, I'm going to mention you guys.
Yeah,
it just came up to me in this conversation. I remembered, in my teaching, one of the things I do is I haven't done it yet this semester, but usually I make a list of all of the great bookstores that are in the New York area. Because I've basically been teaching in the New York City metro area. I've taught at Essex County College, Montclair, Rutgers, and a lot of students are not aware that these bookstores even exist.
Yeah, it's sad because, I think students are not our biggest audience because they're so, totally inundated with work. I mean, to browse in a bookstore is not the easiest thing to do. But I mean, Fred Bass is a good friend and always been very supportive. I like the Strand.
Fred Bass. Oh, yeah, yeah.
The owner of the Strand.
So the next episode will be on solving the educational crisis, and you could be a guest on that.
Well, thank you.
Okay, Jim?
Thank you,
thank you so much for letting us talk to you.
Okay. It was
thank
a
you.
Pleasure.
Okay.
Thank you, Claudia.
Yeah.